Yes.
Thank you. So, with acknowledgement, I have very wonderful talks by Dr. Kamal and Dr. about how to enter the clinic, how to keep social distancing, how to expect what will happen with the staff, the surgeons, and all the people around in the clinic, what guideline they should follow. I'll be focusing mainly, because I knew that these things would be discussed before my talks already. So I'll be focusing on a little more detail. Like, I'm a retina surgeon. Why retina? The things are more important is because retinal surgeries are longer surgeries. They are emergency surgeries. We cannot even refuse so many patients. In the Healing Touch Eye Center, in the last 45 days, we have done more than 15 to 20 procedures. We are three consultants here, and more than 15 to 20 procedures, which we could not refuse, like a giant retinal tear, a trauma patient came. So many different patients have come during these difficult times, and these patients cannot be refused, COVID or no COVID. But say, like Kamal was saying, not to lose heart, we have to move on, we have to take the bend. We are taking the bend and we are taking our precautions and going on. So I am thankful to the guidelines of the All India Ophthalmological Society. I have taken few tips from the American Society of Retina Surgery and some articles from which I'll be telling the details in the next slide. So what is important is teleconsultation is a very, very important thing. If things can be sorted out on telephone or digitally, it is always better. Like on WhatsApp, take a photograph of a picture. If it is just mild conjunctivitis, no problem, nothing doing. But if it is a retina patient, it is very difficult to do imaging also. I think the next talk will be of the teleconsultation talk is going to be there by Dr. Anjani. She's also a retina specialist and she will understand that teleconsultation is easy. But for retina people, it is not very easy because you need specialized cameras and equipment to have a fundus photograph at least to tell something about the retina. So, but teleconsultation definitely helps because it will reduce the footfall of the clinic. Many patients, you can sort out the things when the patient is sitting there. It is very good in retina also for a follow-up. Like we are giving intravitreal injections. We really don't need patient to come back after every injection that we have given, especially a patient who has gone multiple injections. Unnecessary travel and time waste reduce, and it decreases the chance of the COVID spread also. So history taking on phone is very important. Before the patient even comes in, you can take a history, whether you have had any fever, you had any cough, is any family member COVID positive, or any patient quarantined, or any family member quarantined in your house also. If yes, because Delhi has a very clear-cut system of having COVID hospital and non-COVID hospital. If you have any doubt before even the patient coming to the clinic, we can always say, please don't come to our clinic. If you are COVID positive or you are in under quarantine, go to another hospital, which is a COVID hospital. So general precautions has already been talked about. You have to check about the mask of the patient. The temperature must be taken outside the clinic. And the patient must sanitize his hands, beautifully shown in the video by Dr. Kumar. Doctor, I won't go into details. Coming to the examination of the retina, because I'm talking specifically about retina and vitreoretina. Direct ophthalmoscopy is a complete no. Even if you are wearing the mask or even if you are doing anything else, direct ophthalmoscopy means you are going very, very close to the patient. So please avoid that because there are other better ways. You can do a fundus photograph. Even your technician can take a fundus photograph and give you a picture, which is not really 100% sufficient, but for small pathologies like diabetic retinopathies or anything, you can pick it up. Slit lamp examination, 90D examination. You can see the photographs, how I'm doing an indirect ophthalmoscopy down here. Then I'm taking a fundus photograph myself. And this slit lamp shield, you can see, I hope you can see, this is a slit lamp shield because we have to do lasers also through the slit lamp. We have to do an examination through the slit lamp, even a 90D examination. So slit lamp shield is also a very important thing that can prevent any direct droplets coming from the patient to you. And please don't talk to the patient while examining. Very important. If you are talking with the patient, you are doing a lot of error because patient, when we'll talk, he will have something out from his breath, and it is better to ask the history before, keep him seated little away from you, and that is what is should be followed. Indirect ophthalmoscopy, you can have a, like you can see, you can have a shield along the indirect ophthalmoscope, but I prefer to wear, you can see here, I have marked here, I prefer to wear these glasses. These are simple plastic glasses, and I have found it very, very convenient. They almost stick to your eye, and it is not difficult to perform IO through this. I am sharing my own experience. I am doing this since last 15, 20 days, now more than that. Then what about OCT and angiography? So how do you keep the equipment clean? Keep the equipment clean, like already been said, with alcohol wipes. Change the gloves or sanitize after every exam. patient should always be wearing a mask. You can see the patient is wearing a mask. Doctor, myself, I am always wearing a double mask, and I am wearing gloves. And this OT linen gown is good enough. You don't have to be really scared. Nothing is going to penetrate through the gown and through your clothes. So I have the hospital clothes underneath this. I come and change in the hospital, wear the hospital gown, the gloves, and then a double mask, and my cap is always there. No relative should be allowed inside. And OCT angiography is preferred to floor scene angiography, which is a non-invasive procedure. And ICT is best avoided because, again, it is a lengthy procedure. During these times, lengthy procedures should be avoided. What do we do while doing laser? Non-contact method preferred. You can see this photograph. This is not my actual photograph, but you can see non-contact methods are always preferred because distance, it will help in maintaining the distance. Always have the patient wear the mask, and you also wear a mask, and avoid scleral depression. We tend to do a lot of scleral depression, but during these days, it will be wiser not to do depression. This can lead to the spread of the infection. And do not talk to the patient. Very, very important point, not to talk to the patient. That is a very important point. Precaution while doing laser, we should prefer a multi-spot laser because that is faster, lesser time. One point which nobody has really highlighted is the exposure time. I have read lot of articles during the last few days preparing for this thing. They say that the exposure time is also very important. That is why we see why the restaurants are not opening up, why the cinema halls are not opening up. The contact time with the patient also matters. That is why a surgery that is to be done should be done in these days, at least not by people who are under training. The time period involved with a patient who is suffering, he may be an asymptomatic COVID patient. If you spend less time, there is less chance of the COVID infection coming on to you. And like described earlier, povidone iodine drops after procedure, even after laser procedures, we are putting this povidone iodine drops. They really don't hurt if you have already put in a local anesthetic. How do we clean the lenses? So lenses can be cleaned ideally with a soap and water, because doing them with any other solution like alcohol or sodium hypochlorite may harm these lenses. So have a soft sponge, don't have a cloth also. Soft sponge is the best way to keep the lenses clean. Ideally, beforehand also, before this COVID started, these are the best recommendations. Don't clean them with a dry cloth. Don't clean them with distilled water because that will lead to the shorter life of the lenses. And we don't want a short life of any instrument, things going so expensive these days. So clean one lens at a time and dry the lens with a low-lint cotton. And what we can do is, you can see the non-optical surface of the lens. If you want to be over-protective, either you have gloves in your hands or cling film over the non-optical surface, which can be changed after each patient. How to clean the slit lamp? All non-optical surfaces with alcohol spray. So you can see here, I've highlighted here, the headrest, the chin rest. It is important to clean them with alcohol after every patient, after every use. So all contact areas, very, very important, along with the handle with the patient keeps. And ideally, the spray should be done on the seat also where the patient is sitting. How to do with the V-scan probes? Again, V-scan probe, not very difficult to clean. A clean alcohol wipe can be used after every patient. And touchscreen devices can be covered with cling film. There are so many instruments now, even for LASIK, for everything, touchscreen devices can be covered with cling film over which we can spray solutions and then keep on removing them regularly after every few patients. For electrophysiology, preferable to use disposable electrodes and clean the wires with alcohol wipes. So that's why I've given a picture of alcohol wipes. Coming to the surgical part. What do we do before surgery? Before washing, as we are already doing surgeries, even during the COVID period, we never stopped doing retina surgeries. Prior to washing, the mask should be worn. Wear N95 mask. To me, because I am a little bit sleep apnea person also, N95 mask is very difficult to me. So I am using 3-ply surgical mask, but I use 2 masks. Like you will see in my pictures also forward. I'll show you the pictures I've shown you earlier also. I use 2 3-ply surgical masks. Shoe covers and goggles and caps must be worn before we enter the OT. So before entering, these things must be worn. Then after washing, waterproof sterile gown, if possible, it is very good. And over that, you can either wear, because we should not be very, very scared. Things are not that bad. We have to be careful that we have covered up ourselves adequately and the patient is also adequately covered up. But we should cover ourselves up only to the point that we are able to do the surgery. Initially, I used the first few days I started doing surgery with those PPE gowns and with the zippers and all almost airtight things and AC not on, it was almost impossible for me to operate. So I switched over to changing my clothes, wearing these clean linen of the OT dress, and then over that preferably a waterproof sterile gown. And touch wood, till date we are all okay. You can see me again wearing goggles. with goggles, we can definitely do this surgery with the microscope. Through the microscope, I don't feel any problem. And this, you can see the double mask. I am wearing two masks. I discard one mask after every surgery. Coming to intravitreal injections, very important thing. What was in pre-COVID era? Pre-COVID era, we used to do full OT sepsis, gown, mask, and gloves like everybody does. In USA, people used to do even in the OPD, but now they have changed also. Post-COVID era, the patient wears mask. Earlier, the patient never used to wear mask when we used to give injections. Now the surgeon is wearing the mask, N95 mask or a double mask. Only one injection is loaded per patient. In a heavy days, the pre-COVID eras, we used to sometimes load because, you know, for three or four patients, we used to load the injection and keep it separately for separate patient. But these days, we are not following that. We are taking only one injection loaded, changing the whole set for the next patient and minimum 10-minute gap between two patients so that the OT staff can completely sterilize the area, the OT table and everything. So follow-up of intravitreal injection, because intravitreal injection is a thing which we cannot stop. Even in America, Europe, I have read so many articles. During COVID times also, they were giving these injections because these injections cannot be stopped. Once they stop, there is a high chance of losing the eye. So, but we can stop calling them for follow-ups. A patient who has already undergone two or three injections intravitreal, we can not call them for the follow-up like we used to do for first 24 to 48 hours. We can wait for a few days, talk to him on phone once a week, and if the patient is fine, he can come when we feel that there is a time for his next injection, or when there is some trouble with the patient, if there is a drop in the vision or the patient feels some problem. Coming to vitreoretinal surgery, why is it essential to protect oneself? Like I told in the beginning of my talk, mostly vitreoretinal surgeries are emergency surgeries. It will be very, very difficult to delay. Only those patients we can confidently postpone whom we know are COVID positive. And because government has given the ruling that COVID positive patients can be sent to COVID positive hospitals, so we cannot delay. The duration of surgery is longer. So that is why contact time, the contact time principle is very important. Retina cataract surgery, LASIK surgery, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, maximum 15 minutes. But retina surgeons sometimes have to suffer 1 hour, even 2 to 3 hours also, depending on the case. So sometimes the general anesthesia is also required, the point which has not been touched so far. General anesthesia, the anesthetist has to take really special precaution, because anesthetist giving GA is the most prone to catch a COVID from a patient who is suffering from one. So GA is also required sometimes during these long surgeries. So we must be very, very careful. Try to finish the surgery safely and as fast as possible. That is why this is not the time to teach or let your interns or residents do your surgeries for you, or even say the end of the surgery when you are giving, say, to suture the conjunctiva. Everything should be done by the same surgeon and the same fast team. Don't rely on people who are not fast. Patient protocols. Patient to wear mask and to be taped. The mask over the patient should be taped, and 5% povidone iodine drops must be put prior to patient coming into the OT. And we are always doing this. We were always practicing this before in the pre-COVID era, and we are still following the same. And when the patient, before we start the surgery, we are doing these betadine drops. And the drapes should be watertight. You can see this plastic drapes, avoid lint drapes. And these are the watertight drapes, along with, you can say, a drainage bag here. All the fluid is going into the drainage bag. Luckily, in the retina surgeries, there is not a lot of aerosol formation like Doctor was showing in his video of the FACO. In our surgeries, there is no aerosol, very minimal if it is so, and I have not found any study. So, but betadine cleaning is a very, very important factor even to reduce the chances of endophthalmitis. So, coming to the surgical techniques, we should try to use valve cannulas as far as possible, prevent fluid spills, especially during the fluid air exchange, because fluid air exchange is one step of the surgery where we can really cause some aerosol formation. Vitrectomy to be preferred over scleral buckling, because scleral buckling, a lot of suturing is to be done. You are coming in contact with a lot of body fluids, and it sometimes takes longer also. So surgery speed to reduce contact time, and extra care of disinfecting surfaces, and no reuse of instrument between two patients. That is very, very important, because we have the tendency sometimes we may use a cutter or we change the cutter, but the tubing is the same. All things are now being changed since the time of the COVID. We don't even reuse the tubings that are coming from the cassette. Sometimes we were using the cassettes again, but now we don't do it. Now we are changing for every patient, even the vitrectomy cassettes. If they have to be reused, are reused only after doing drying them, doing a proper ETO, and then using the next or the third or fourth day, not the same day. Then roll off 3D vitrectomy is going to increase as technology is coming in. Everything digital, fingerprint machine is not now going to help. You know, it is going to be face recognition or maybe through the mask recognition. Then role of 3D vitrectomy, because it is a contact like surgery. You don't have to come close to the patient. There are no, as you can see in this microscope, there are no binoculars. So this surgery is doing sitting back, relaxed with the hands inside the eye. It is like a endoscopic surgery. So 3D surgery, like the Ingenuity system of Alcon, they may gain from this COVID era. And even cataract surgeries can be done beautifully through this Ingenuity system. I have myself not practically done surgery through this, but I have attended many sessions, practical sessions also, and I have really had a feel of this technology. And I hope that technology will help us. We should try to take as much precautions as possible. And thank you very much for everything. And this is just to share, my daughter and myself, we sometimes make her. This is a chocolate smoothie she makes with me. And like everybody was saying, doctor was saying, Dr. Kamal was saying, we should relax the time extra we get. We are making, this is my own production with the help of my daughter. So after this, again, my daughter is ready with something. Some food is being made. I think some noodles today. And we should enjoy our time, spend some time with the family, and take all the precautions and hope for the best. Thank you very much.